It is impossible to bear up under grief by one's own strength alone. And I say grief here today because though there is a hope that shines, there is most assuredly grief. However, I would say to you that the grief that this family and many friends and we experience today is not built upon the way things must be. The grief is built upon the way things are promised to be someday and are not now. It's a different kind of grief than the world knows. And so I say to you, welcome today as you help this dear family grieve as those who have hope. Welcome, everyone. Let's pray. Lord, the only way that we have the strength to gather and to remember and to hope is because you have promised us that you are not done. You are not done with Jack. You are not done with any of us, Lord, until that day when all who count on Christ are raised and are together with one another and with you. And we long for that time when we will no longer have funerals, when we will no longer have graveyards, cemeteries, when that will be a thing of the past. For now, let us sit with the grief that comes with not being able to converse with a loved one and live in that loved one's presence. Let us sit with that grief together and remind each other that this is not the end. We ask you to remind us of that during these moments together today. In Christ we pray. Amen.
Weariness.
Jack Allen Locke was born on the 22nd of January, 1932, right here in San Antonio, to Allie Locke and Lois Draper Locke. And he passed peacefully from this life on the 16th of January, just a few days ago, the age of 88. Jack lived in San Antonio through high school, graduating from Jefferson in 1949. He received a football scholarship to attend Shriner Institute in Kerrville, now Shriner University, where he met his future wife, Sue Lovewell. They were married on the 30th of November of 1951, 69 years recently, 69 years. Jack furthered his education in mechanical engineering at Texas A&M University, earning his bachelor's in 53, his master's in 54, and a PhD in 68, all from A&M. And while earning these degrees, he and Sue raised three daughters. And when he graduated in 1954 from A&M, his professional career began at General Dynamics in Fort Worth. And from 60 to 64, then Jack taught at Arlington State College, now UT Arlington, part of the UT system, also working to create and accredit the engineering program there at UTA. In 68, Jack and his family moved back to San Antonio, where Jack joined Southwest Research Institute, and in 84, he retired from there and began private consulting. Now, during his career, Jack was a member of the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, a registered professional engineer in the state of Texas. Other honors and awards included Phi Theta Kappa, Tau Beta Pi, Phi Kappa Phi, Humble Oil Company Fellowship, Atomic Energy Commission grant, as well as an NDEA Title IV Fellowship. That's a lot of alphabet soup there, but it speaks highly of Jack's acumen. Jack and his family joined First Baptist Church right here when they moved back in 68. And he was a faithful and involved member until his death. Over the years, he was a Bible teacher to the International Sunday School class for language students from Lackland Air Force Base, and a tutor in the ABLE English Studies series. He humbly served as deacon, member, and chair, and was a prayer partner in the telephone ministry. And I remember that very well. Jack traveled on many mission trips, Jemez, New Mexico. He volunteered for several years at 4th Street Cafe. Some of you will remember that. In recognition of his lifetime service to the Lord, FBCSA honored Jack as the 2011 Floyd Cadwallader Heritage Award recipient, to which he replied, "It's been fun." That's typical lack of verbosity for an engineer. In addition to investing in friends and ministry to others, Jack was drawn to and spiritually fed by nature's design. His early years were filled with hunting, fishing, bug collecting. Hunting season brought annual treks to the family lease in West Texas, where deer and turkey filled many a freezer for the year to come. He and Sue enjoyed several road trips with friends and were filled by the beauty of our country, our vast country. Some of the best hours were spent in his own backyard watching birds and squirrels scramble over the same feeder bounty. Many might be surprised to know that Jack was also a poet, having been caught without a card for a special occasion more than once. He wrote a poem for the occasion and discovered he had a knack for verse. It became a badge of honor to be the recipient of a Jack Locke poem. Jack knew something about daughters, of course, having raised three of his own. One of my own daughters has recounted many times how Jack endeared himself to her and her gaggle of friends on Sunday mornings here at First Baptist Church. In our early years here, our youngest was in middle school, and she and a pack of her friends would always come up to the office area because they never ceased in their amazement that the office had a vending machine for snacks. And so they would scrounge up some money and go in there and buy some snacks before church, right after Sunday school. And inevitably, Jack was sitting there in that break room up there waiting to be a part of the phone ministry team or some such endeavor. And my daughter began telling me that, "Dad, there's this man up there who's sitting in the break room every time we go to get a snack, and he always says to us, 'Well, hello, boys.'" And he said, "I don't think he knows we're girls." And I thought, "Who is this person?" Well, she told me he has the bluest eyes. And eventually I figured out, once I got close enough to Jack to see his blue eyes, I thought, okay, that's the man. And then one day, our daughter came home and said, and this is months later, if not a year later, she said, "Dad, that man was up there today." I said, "Mr. Locke?" "Oh yeah, Mr. Locke, he was there today. And he said, 'Hello, boys,' to us again. And then he adjusted his glasses and he said, 'Wait a minute, y'all aren't boys, y'all are girls.'" And she just thought that was hilarious, and she just loved him so much. And she was heartbroken when I told her that he had passed away. And she recounted that story once again. Jack was preceded in death by his parents and is survived by his loving, dear wife, Sue, and their three daughters, Beverly Dugas and her husband Norman, Jeanette Rudd and her husband Wiff, Connie Inman and her husband Richard. Jack and Sue have been blessed with seven grandchildren: Jeffrey Dugas, Laura Dugas Zimmerman, Joshua Rudd and wife Kristen, Andrew Rudd and wife Shannon, Taylor Rudd, wife Diana, Stephanie Inman Plakowski, and husband Stephen, Richard A. Inman, husband Alex, wife Alex, nine great-grandchildren, numerous cousins, nieces, nephews. Jack professed Christ as an undergrad. He did not come to decisions like that lightly. He was convinced. He became convinced and placed the weight of his faith, shifted that onto Christ. He was true to his convictions. A family member says he was a man with brilliant mind and beautiful heart. He loved to converse with people on his level, engaging their intellect. He was, of course, convinced that he was right, but because he had charted it all out in his mind. But then he also learned how to identify rolled eyes. That lesson came with his oldest daughter. Sorry to divulge family secrets there. He was a man of, and we speak from our perspective, as you understand, in the past tense, but Jack has not ceased to exist. He's with the Lord. So from our standpoint, he was, but we will come to know that he is. He was a man of great faithfulness and generosity, stewarding oil royalties for the Lord's work. He was mission-minded. The aforementioned Jemez mission trips were dear to him. Jack was also conscious of social inequities. He there was a place in his heart that had grown wide with love and an empathy for those who were marginalized. And his work with internationals spoke of that. He shared his mind and shared his possessions. And everyone, an obituary is a record of a life. But the best record of his life, you know what the best record of his life is? You. You are the best record of Jack's life. The imprint. Your very existence, of course, but then the imprint on family and friends and church, the way that he affected you and then you turned around and affected him. It was a beautiful dance of love, really. And here we are, remembering him and longing for the day that we will see him again. There are people who know him far better than I did, and we will turn this space over to them now as they give tribute.
Good afternoon and welcome. On behalf of the entire family, we appreciate your attendance here today and joining us in the celebration of Jack's life. I'm Norman Dugas, married to Beverly, Jack and Sue's oldest daughter. Normally, I would say that I'm the number one son-in-law, but because Wiff and Richard are here today, I will just say that I'm the son-in-law number one. It's amazing to think that Jack was only 37 years old when I started dating Beverly. I wasn't much of a future son-in-law material, being a lifelong University of Texas fan and future alumnus. I like to think that I set the bar low enough so that Wiff and Richard would have an easier time of it dating Jeanette and Connie. The reality is that Jack and Sue welcomed me into their family, and I am forever grateful for them sharing their love with me. As the pastor alluded, most of you know Jack as the PhD mechanical engineer from Texas A&M, precise and exacting, one of the smartest technical minds I've ever known. But there was a creative side to Jack, expressed often in the form of a poem. I'd like to read a portion of one that the girls selected. This is the 30th of November, 2015, coincidentally, an anniversary date. Dear Sue, no card again? What do I do? Yes, write a little poem for you. Time is short, this must be too. This day is just for me and you. Our wedding day, let's not forget how blessed we were when we met. How blessed I am still, you're with me. This, our 64th anniversary. I'd like to share three stories that are examples of some of Jack's better known characteristics. The first being his knowledge of what was best for Jack, his manifestation of Christ's love through his actions, and the depth of his conviction in the Word of God. What was best for Jack? As many of you know, Jack had peripheral neuropathy and eventually needed to have hand controls for his car. He did extensive research on what was available commercially, and none of it suited him. So what did he do as the mechanical engineer? He designed, built, and with the help of one of his grandsons, installed them, passing state inspection, and drove with his homemade hand controls on the car for years. He knew what he wanted. A few years ago, I was driving Jack home from dinner one night in his car. The headlights were not set on automatic. I asked him why not, and he said, quote, "I like to be the one in charge of when my lights are on or off. It may come as no surprise to you, but I'm a bit of a control freak." Jack knew what was best for Jack. The love of Christ, we talked about many examples as the pastor talked about, numerous awards and recognition, Sunday school teacher, deacon, international students, prayer partner, TV ministry, 4th Street Cafe, many, many more. My favorite story illustrating Jack's love involves a family member who had done something that they felt Jack might not approve of. So they want to get out in front of the story. They call Jack and Sue to explain the situation and ask for their forgiveness. Jack's reply, "Child, God doesn't love you any less today than he did yesterday, and neither do I." I think of no better example of letting Christ's love show through than Jack's actions that day. Jack's faith in the Word of God. Jack was a serious student of the Bible, believing very strongly in the promises of God. A couple of years ago, before his heart valve surgery, I happened to be with Jack in the hospital when his wonderful, saintly cardiologist came in to discuss the diagnosis and recommended treatment. At this point, we revert back to example number one. Jack likes to be in charge of all things Jack. After a thorough discussion of the recommended treatment, Jack asked the doctor what could happen if he decided not to have the valve replacement. Dr. Welford said, "Well, Jack, you might very well die." Jack turned and looked at Dr. Welford and said, "I have no fear of death. I don't want to die, but I am not afraid." Jack knew deep in his heart what the promises of God meant for him. No doubt, no fear, just faith.
Hello, everyone. I am the second oldest grandson, Jeffrey. And kind of put together a little something that just reminded me of my grandfather, and you know, that was, I think, what many people talk about: his faith, his love of his family, his fantastic mind. But what some people don't have it as much, but he had great head of hair. To my grandfather, I think we can all agree what a great man he was. Kind and open-hearted, but at the same time, a little bit rough around the stern. My grandfather was a brilliant man, but he would never claim it out loud. And of course, he always knew the best way to do something, but at the same time was quick to share his knowledge and explaining why it should be done this way. When I think of my grandfather, it's the four things aforementioned, and just kind of as a little tribute, not realizing how much of the silent poet he had become, I just kind of jotted something down for him. And it starts with, "Locks of hair that could rival a prickly pear, a mind that matched Albert Einstein, and a faith in God like only one other in humankind. He loved his whole family like no other. but I know he had a special place in his heart for my grandmother. So
well, I'm Richard Inman, and I guess you would say I'm the last son-in-law. I have notes here from some of the grandchildren. The first is from Laura, and I need to emphasize that because of the start of it, and you'll understand in a second. It says, when I was a little girl, I had no idea my grandfather was a poet. He was always so matter-of-fact and mathematical with his thinking. However, in his later years, he wrote so many beautiful poems and was beginning to give them to us, his family, as gifts and gestures of his deep grandfatherly love. So today I found it fitting to try and put my love and memories for him into a poem, and it's titled Jack. J, just about the most beautiful soul you'll ever know. A, all around, hands down, best pancake maker in the whole world. C, carpenter, engineer, with strong working man's hands that were yet still so gentle to hold during a prayer. K, kindness, love, generosity, and full of God's light. You will be remembered always and loved forever. From my daughter Stephanie came a quick note, and she said, I remember growing up at least once in every visit, I was the recipient of a, quote, teachable moment. And those of you that know Jack know exactly what we're talking about. She said, I never knew until one hunting trip that there was a proper way to open a hot cocoa packet. In latter years, I learned to enjoy his words of love and encouragement. Joshua wrote, Grandfather passed away early this morning. My grandmother, mother, and one of my aunts were able to visit him in person at the hospital last night, and the rest of us were able to Zoom with him. He told each of us how proud he was of us, that he loved us, and that he was thankful for the life God had given him. He wasn't afraid. He was ready to meet his maker he feared and loved. When I was growing up, Grandfather felt rough around the edges to me. Far from perfect, he was a perfectionist with particular ideas how things should be done. Remember the hot cocoa packet, but anyway. As an engineer and an inventor, he was always solving problems he came across and was eager to share his knowledge. As he grew older, many of his strong opinions changed to new strong opinions. He never stopped learning and growing. Patience, gentleness, and gratitude took more prominence. Moments meant something. Some things could just be the way they were. He became quite the poet. Anyone who met Grandfather knew two things about him. He loved Jesus and he loved his family. Rest in peace, Grandfather. I'm going to miss you on this earth. May your memory be eternal. And finally, from my son Rich, he said, my favorite memory of Grandfather was going with him and Meemaw to the Grand Canyon. It was during a road trip between Texas and Washington State. I don't remember what direction we were going, but on the way, we stopped by a few places to sightsee. The Grand Canyon is vast and complex. We stood on its edge looking over the sweeping range. The other side showed a spectrum of colors from the catalog of rock layers that had been carved out of the earth. I think Grandfather and I got to enjoy something God created together. We stood and every piece of the canyon and seeing how it made up the whole beautiful work of God's creation. I look forward to more of those moments when, with Grandfather, when we are reunited in the Lord's presence.
For those that have forgotten, I'm the baby of the family, but I'm here. My sisters and I got together, and this is what we kind of came up with. Some of it's repetitious, but that's okay, because Dad repeated himself a few times. How do we share about our dad? Time will not allow. There is so much to tell. He loved God. He loved family. He loved nature. He loved everyone. Our dad was special. If you needed it, he could build it. If it was broken, he could fix it or rework it. If you had a question, boy, did he have an answer. He was a gifted teacher and invested his time in all endeavors. He loved the outdoors. He pitched balls to us. He taught us skills at tennis and table tennis. He taught us to hunt for our food. Venison and turkey were frequently on the menu. We took annual vacations to any place he could fish. We were blessed to tag along to help with the lures, carry the fish, steer the boat, etc., you know. In his later years, he would sit outside and enjoy nature in motion. As was said, the bird bath was frequented by a wide variety of birds, as was the bird feeder. The squirrels trying to get to the seeds brought their own source of entertainment. Dad was always busy. Inventing, planning, measuring, more equations, more planning, and final completion of the project at hand. His brain was never idle. He always began his day with a cup of coffee and his Bible in fellowship with our Lord. Dad took time to invest in friends and neighbors. You want to travel? Let's plan a trip. Need a hand? I'll be right there. Sick or injured? Split pea soup coming up. Growing up with Dad was challenging. He didn't really know what to do with three girls. Teenage arguments, dress hem lengths, pierced ears, boys, all uncharted territory. But he managed with Christ-like dignity, and we're certain with lots of prayer. In our younger days, all three of us remember our turn at sitting on the hand crank ice cream freezer, a little cold. Ice, newspaper, beach towel, you know, try to keep us warm there. But this gave us the right to lick the beater, the dasher, I'm sorry. He took great pains to be fair and equal to us. When he went golfing with his dad, our grandfather, Gramps, there were three electric golf carts to attend the two of them. We each drove one, and they walked. As we grew up, he remained family-oriented. He loved to give hugs. He loved to sit and talk for a while, even over the phone. He was witty. He would have us in stitches. He loved to travel to where we all lived, even to Okinawa. Dad became quite a poet, as you have discovered. Blessed is each recipient of a Jack Locke poem. He was a great cook. His recipes are written with all the instructions. For instance, in his famous peanut brittle recipe, he writes, "I use a sudden increase of burning in my eyes to end the cooking." With trial and error, he developed the right mix of spices that made everything taste wonderful. Mrs. Dash, the original Mrs. Dash, dill weed, chicken bouillon, garlic powder, and cumino were his favorites. As long as he was at home, he was in the kitchen. He became our best friend, but most of all, he was a true servant of God. He instilled in each of us a love for Jesus and a desire to serve him. Even on his last day here on earth, and through the miracle of Zoom, with a strong voice, Daddy shared his love and gave each of us his blessing to his children, grandchildren, and great-grandkids. As we said goodnight, it was obvious he was a humble servant, excited to see Jesus face to face.
together in these moments to add our voice, to say we love you and we are with you in this journey and in whatever way a family can be. So let's stand together as we proclaim, this is my story, this is my song. You'll find the music on the back of your bulletin. Let's sing together.
Salvation, purchase of God.
hear now this passage of scripture from Ecclesiastes. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that people will fear him. Whatever is has already been, and whatever has been before. And God will call the past to account. This is the word of the Lord. This passage speaks of a universe run in an orderly fashion by God. Whatever was orderly appealed to Jack. Have we established that? The alternative was chaos. And the engineer in him and the control freak in the colloquial parlance recoiled at that idea of chaos. Whenever Jack did encounter chaos, it deeply disturbed him. He saw it externally, sometimes at church conference meetings from time to time. If you've ever sat through a business meeting with Jack, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Out come the white papers on why this is not a good idea or why another version of it should be tried. He would happily bend your ear about it if you would agree. So he saw chaos externally sometimes. He saw it internally. This is a little complicated. Some people felt intimidated by Jack. I was one of those people, and I was sharing with the family the other day when I first met him, I thought he didn't like me. Maybe I represented chaos to him, I don't know. He was an only child, and he was held up on a pedestal to some degree by his family of origin. But this has varying effects, and with Jack, he sometimes second-guessed himself and wondered if he could measure up to such a pedestal upon which he had been placed. He experienced periods of depression, wandering in that kind of emotional wilderness sometimes. And that was a chaotic feeling internally. And so the Creator himself would speak order into the chaos. The Creator, that aspect of God appealed to Jack. Beautiful aspect of God. Creator would speak order into the chaos that Jack encountered Jack recounted times that God spoke directly to him. Sue will be healed of cancer. And so it was. There was a time when he wondered where he stood with God. Surely God could not have saved him. Doubt crept in. And doubt is a common human experience. We're not finite, so we doubt. Or we're not infinite, that is, so we doubt. We're just finite. We don't know beyond the boundaries. Jack experienced that. And God spoke to him. You're mine. That's what he needed to hear. God has set eternity in the human heart. The scripture we just read tells us, and this word eternity is variously translated. Some versions, English language versions of the Bible, translate it ignorance. That is to say, God has made it so that we can't know everything. So sometimes that word is translated eternity, sometimes it's translated something akin to ignorance. And at the intersection of eternity and ignorance, there lies the human capacity for wonder. Wonder is the place at which you can't really lay everything out in equations or schematics. But wonder is not the same thing as chaos. Jack was at home with wonder, because wonder engages the mind, and there is a time for wonder. There was a time for marveling at and peering into mystery in Jack's life. Some of these times of wonder happened years earlier when he became familiar with the aforementioned eye roll. Wonder is the place his poetry came from. And some of it happened, some of that wonder happened as his own death approached, and he had the opportunity to marvel once again at love. The family told me the night we visited him at the hospital, every other word was love. He was able to speak to all of his grandchildren, as the family shared a few moments ago, on the eve of his death. Love. How marvelous. And Jack wondered at it. There's a time for everything. And Jack was increasingly at peace with the reality that all times are in Christ's hands. This is where Jack's wonder and faith landed, in the person of Christ. Solid ground, solid rock, not chaos. Christ is, for Jack and for all who will count on Christ, the one who will order your life and guard you from chaos, both now and for eternity. Jack counted on Christ. And Jack was no pushover. He didn't fall for empty claims. He could spot a shaky proposition or an ill-conceived notion a mile away, and when he saw Christ, he knew. Here, at last, is one who will bring beauty and order out of all things. Here is the one who will make a place for a person to stand, and who will make everything beautiful in its time. Jack would say to you, and I say to you, count on Christ. and your whole life will be saved. Think for a moment about how you knew Jack in his lifetime here on this earth. Think about what it was like to look into his eyes, to clasp his hand, to hug his neck, to hear his voice, to turn around in a business meeting wondering who that is speaking, and there's Jack, to see him from across a room and recognize his form. There's Jack. Now, all of these ways that I have mentioned about knowing Jack, looking into his eyes, hugging his neck, clasping his hand, hearing his voice, all of these are ways that we knew him in the body. And we often say, well, Jack's body has failed him, it has died, and his spirit is with the Lord, and that is true. But do you think for a moment that the Lord is done? Who made Jack's body? Who formed him out of the dust of the ground? And who gave us a blueprint, a preview, if you will, for all who count on Christ by coming out of the grave? The Lord. The body that went into the grave is the body that came out of the grave, the Lord Jesus. He appeared to his disciples and he said, "Peace be to you." And we would expect something like that from the Lord Jesus. But he also said, "Do you have anything to eat?" Which is not something we might expect from the Lord Jesus. I have yet to see that in a stained glass window. Do you have anything to eat? And yet, there it is. The Lord is the Creator. And he will see his creation through, spirit and body. And so Jack's spirit is with the Lord. And one day, the witness of the Bible and the cornerstone of our faith tells us that he will raise Jack's body up and it will no longer fail him. If you want to look into Jack's eyes again, how much more does the Lord want to look into those eyes again, the one who made those eyes? So don't worry about that. He will raise Jack up, and all who count on Christ will be there to hug Jack's neck again and to clasp his hand and to hear his voice. A lot of other religions teach life after death in some form or another, reincarnation, becoming one with the universe, being remembered by your loved ones. Only the Bible teaches resurrection, life in the body, in this good universe that God created once again, living and never dying. And so we will always be with the Lord. This is the promise Jesus makes. This is the Christ Jack counted on. And all who count on that Christ will live again in such a way. From that place of confidence, you will find the strength to live fully, to wonder at the beauty and mystery, and to love those around you deeply now and forever. Will you count on Christ? Jack did. So can you. Let's pray. Lord, you have loved us enough to give us someone like Jack to remind us that you bring order out of chaos. And we thank you that you have given Jack to us and that he is now safe with you. We thank you for all the promises that have yet to unfold. And we pray that everyone in this room and everyone touched by Jack's life would come to know the same Savior that he himself planted his feet on that same rock. Thank you for loving us that much. In Christ we pray. Amen.
thank you for joining us today. Thank you for helping celebrate with us today this good, good man. As we're dismissed, I want to speak to those that are watching live stream. The slideshow that we had before the service will continue to play. So if you didn't get to see that, the family wants you to be able to see those wonderful pictures of Jack and the family. So as we're dismissed, after I pray, I'm going to ask that you stand. And in lieu of a receiving line, which we can't do these days, the family wants to, as they walk out, see you and wave at you. So after I get done praying, I'll stand you, and then we'll dismiss the family and dismiss you afterwards. Let's pray. Lord, your scripture tells us that precious in your sight is the death of one of your saints. It's that scripture that we hold dear right now, Lord, because we love Jack. And to know that you love him too brings us comfort. And Lord, as we look forward in these days ahead, it is my prayer and the prayer of this church that all these here would love you the way Jack loved you. And so we could say with great confidence one day that we will stand with you as well. So, Lord, as we go from here, we pray especially for Sue and just ask that you will surround her with your love that is supernaturally strong and wonderful, and help her to feel your presence in these days ahead. Thank you for her family that has loved and cared for her so well. And help us to be the family, the church family that you have called us to be, to care for this family in the days ahead. And so now, Lord, in all these the things that we pray in your name, knowing that you have heard us. Amen. Would you stand with me?